Well, good morning. Welcome to this early morning session on engaging in young adults with ministry. I'm actually surprised there's some young adults that are up, actually, this morning and with us. Well, we are really excited and for this opportunity to that the bishop had asked for a space for some young adult voices that have space here at annual conference and to share some things that are close to our heart and important to us. Part of it, as we talked about this, as the bishop kind of expressed his desire to have a space for young adult voices, one of the things, the questions we asked was, well, what kind of voices, what questions do we want to ask? What is going to be most helpful? What might be helpful for our churches that would be outwardly focused, that would help us in our mission of making disciples? And what we thought about as we really kind of wrestled with this was that one of the things that may be helpful and that we're going to try to do this morning is to look a little bit from the perspective of young adults at a phenomenon that's been in the news a lot, that a lot of us talk about in our churches, and that is the idea that for many of us that young adults are in a way that is different than previous generations, disconnecting from the church and from oftentimes from faith as well. And today we are going to use some work from the Barna Group, from author David Kinneman, from a book he talked about, You Lost Me, to kind of as a springboard to begin this conversation. Now we're going to start off today with Chris Sledge is going to come up and share some statistics and set some context for what we see going on in our culture and our country about young adults. And then we're going to move into a time where we have four young adults, Anna Knox and myself and Mindy Ferguson and Luke Harbaugh, who are going to share a little bit and try and provide some stories and some understanding about some of the disconnections and the themes of disconnection that are brought up in the work of David Kinneman and the Barna Group found. And finally, we're going to end the time with sort of a conversational thing led by Matt Lake, where he's just going to facilitate some conversation, some deeper conversation about this, and also about start to think about what does this mean for us as a church, and what does it look like to create Christian communities that offer authentic community and relationships for young adults. I think and I hope that in some small way this might be helpful for us in our mission of making disciples, and a desire that many of us have to engage young adults. How many of you have that desire? Yeah, right? I remember the first church that I served, there was a woman there named Nancy, and Nancy was one of those people who was just one of the saints of the church. I mean, you know of these women and these men. When I got there, she was in her early 70s, and she was one of those women who, when you met her, you could just see that somehow God had done this great work within her over years of scripture and of prayer and of study and of worship and being in the scripture, and she just sort of glowed with the light and the love of Christ. She had generosity and joy that just abounded through her and poured out of her. When I got to the congregation, she was already kind of fairly sick, and at the end of her life, I was visiting her often in the hospital, and I would ask her the question that I always ask of, what do you want me to pray for? And what struck me is that she almost never really asked that I would pray for her health and what she is. She always said, you know, what I really would like you to pray for is my grandchildren, because I pray for them every day, and I worry about them sometimes. And she talked to me in particular about one granddaughter who she had who had been through some difficult things in her life and had completely disconnected from faith in the church. And she said, I pray so desperately every day for her that she might have the faith that I have. When I did Nancy's funeral, I had the opportunity to sit with the family. And as I sat with the family and they shared and they talked about Nancy's faith and how it just exuded out of her and the power of it. And during that time, I had the opportunity to share with the family what Nancy had shared with me and her hope for them that they not only remember her faith, but they might actually have the faith that had sustained her and given her life. And to my surprise, actually, maybe it was a work of God and the prayers of Nancy and a church that was willing to reach out and make connections with all people. About 2 months later, this granddaughter who she had talked about me showed up in the pew with her boyfriend and with a daughter. And to my surprise, she showed up the next week and the week after that and the week after that. 6 months after the funeral for Nancy, I had the great privilege, one of the most powerful moments of my ministry of standing up in front of the church beside her granddaughter, who was standing up to once again recommit herself to Christ and the church and to become a part of the church. To stand beside the boyfriend, then fiancé, who had never made a public profession of Christ and stood up for the first time to be baptized and to profess his faith in Christ, and to hold in my arms her great-granddaughter and to baptize her into the faith as well. As we begin and move into this session, what I want you to hear and what you want you to think about, you know, this, we're going to talk about statistics in a moment. We're going to talk about this phenomenon of young adults disconnecting from church and the faith. But at the heart of this is an issue about our children, our grandchildren, and for those of us who are up here, our peers, who we long that they would just not know about our faith, but that they might come to have a faith of their own. As we begin to talk about that, we're going to start by looking at this phenomenon of young adults and begin by looking at a video that comes from David Kinnaman as he talks about this phenomenon, as he talks about of how the church has so often lost young adults.
I'm a current seminary student at Wesley Theological Seminary, and I have the honor of being on staff at Fishing Creek Salem UMC working with young adults. A few weeks ago, I had the honor of participating in a local high school baccalaureate service. As I stood up sharing my thoughts with the up-and-coming high school graduates, I had this deep fear rise up in me. I had the fear and the realization for the very first time or for another time that the majority of these high school graduates will never walk into a church again. A bold claim, but a realistic one. Over the past 18 months, I've had the honor of working with young adults as a director of a young adult ministries. And through a plethora of conversations I've had with these young adults, I've realized that there is a deep disconnect between young adults and faith communities these days. The mere survey of any one of our congregations in the Susquehanna Conference, we realize that there's a lack of young adult presence. Many of us have asked that golden question before: how do we get more young adults in our church? The simple question of why? Why are young adults not engaged in the church is often uttered by many of us. What I've realized over the last 18 months is that this question cannot be answered with a simple response or through a mere blog post of the top new ways to reach young adults. Because the problem is more deeper and more nuanced. Because there are currently 50 million young adults in the United States, which makes up about 15% of our population. But who are these 50 million young adults? Well, the traditional answer for any one of us would be, well, someone between the ages of 18 and 35. Some young adults I surveyed recently, I asked them, how would you identify your age group? And I got three responses. The first one is a time period. The second one was, it's a season of life. So those two seem normal. And the third one was like, I think it's just a lifestyle. The reality is then that this age group is so diverse. This group of people consists of college students at any institution of higher education. These are young adults who are working full time or seeking to work full time. They're married, they're single, they're dating. They may be parents, they may be single parents. They may already be divorced, or they may even be widow or widowers. So now as I begin sharing with you some statistics about this diverse generation, I want you to keep two things in mind. The first one is there are different kind of dropouts, as well as faithful young adults who never drop out at all. And we can see some of them here at annual conference. And so we first need to take care to not lump an entire generation together, because each story of disconnection requires a personal, tailor-made response. And I think this is why program language is no longer effective. Number two, I believe that the dropout problem at its core is a faith development problem. And to use church language, it's a disciple-making problem. The church is not adequately preparing the next generation to follow Christ faithfully in a rapidly changing culture. So young adults are known as the missing generation in the church. According to You Lost Me, written by David Kinnaman, he would share these statistics. 61% of young adult Protestants ages 18 to 29 have dropped out of church after attending regularly. So what this means is 61% of our youth groups, 61% of our church youth won't be a part of the church once they graduate high school. Another statistic is 57% of all young adult Christians say that they are just less active in the church compared to when they were 15. Once they reach 15, then their level of involvement is significantly reduced. And the last statistic, which I think is the most staggering, 75% of young adults are currently not attending church on a regular basis. 75% of those who grew up in the church or who did not are not active in the church. And because of this staggering statistic, young adults are often known as the black hole in church attendance. So the reality is the universal church, all churches, churches in our annual conference are struggling with this issue, and we're struggling to be in relationship with young adults effectively. So then I looked at what are the UMC clergy statistics. Here are some to share with you. In the general UMC church, there were 16,290 elders in 2013. And out of those 16,000, only 962 were under 35. So that would give us a 5.91 percentage of young adult clergy. Now in the Northeast jurisdiction, there were 3,042 elders in 2013. Now out of those 3,000, only 126 of them were under 35. That would give us a 4.14 percentage, even lower. Now in our annual conference, in the Susquehanna Conference, all clergy, elders, deacons, local pastors combined, there are 529 clergy in 2013. Out of those 529, 41 of them are under 35, which would give us a little higher percentage compared to the average. It would give us a 7.75 percentage. So through my research and my personal thoughts and through the David Kinnaman work, I think there are two categories to share with you this morning of why I think young adults are disconnected and why they're not participating in our churches. Let's start with the personal challenges. The first personal challenge is we have friends who are just not committed to Christ. If we can believe that 75% of my generation is not engaged in the church, then we would expect myself and my peers to have friends who aren't Christian. And so because of that, that is a personal hindrance for me to be in the church. The second one, there is disappointment with ecclesiastical machinery. I think there is some sort of distrust that I have formed with the church and the hierarchy that established with it. The third one, we have inconsistent mentors. There's either inconsistency in the mentor's personal life or mentors who aren't truly invested in the relationship, so they aren't consistent with it. Number four, I think there are unresolved doubts and personal fragmentation. So in the midst of our young adult years, this is where our identity is formed. This is where we form who we are and what we believe. In the midst of that, then we have doubts. In the midst of our overeducated society where we can learn about anything by going to the internet, that has established many doubts and fragmented what I believe. The fifth one, I think we have young adults have poor personal choices with ongoing impact. The reality is young adults make mistakes, we aren't perfect, and so because of that, I have allowed myself to keep away from the church because I have felt I've been judged. Not saying that the church has judged me, but I have felt that I may be judged because of my lifestyle or because of the things that are in my body. And the last one, I think there's some type of spiritual sabotage. You can use whatever verbiage you want to use behind there, but I think there's an effort out there that's trying to keep this already disengaged generation, keeping it further away from us. So that was personal challenges, and I think now there are six church disconnections from ULASME, and they're on the front of your daily link this morning. So young adult, emerging adults often feel disconnected from the church because it seems first, overprotective. Young adults sense that the church does not value their creativity or cultural engagement, which is very crucial to their lifestyle. So their creativity would produce something new and would presumably be different than traditions. Number two, it's the young adults find the church to be shallow. Some young adults find church to be boring and superficial. Number three, anti-science. With medicine advances, personal technology, travel, care of the natural world, young adults feel that church does not help them interact with science in a positive way. I think a clear example of this is the battle between evolution and creation. Number four, repressive. Religious roles, particularly sexual mores, feel stifling to the individualistic mindset of young adults. Number five, exclusive. Young adults are being shaped by a culture that esteems open-mindedness, tolerance, and acceptance. So thus, Christianity's claim to be exclusive is a hard sell. And the last one, doubtless. Young adults find the church should not be a place to openly share and express their doubts. All of these things, both the personal and the church corporate ones, I think all of these are a barrier for community and for relationships to be formed. These are relational barricades, and this is so crucial because these are millions of lives, millions of young adults' lives that are at stake. So we know millennials are the largest generation in American history, and also are a generation that are disconnecting from church and faith in large numbers that we've seen in generations. The consequences of not paying attention to our disconnected relationships with this generation will have a significant impact on the church. But more than that, I think it's personal for you and I. For me, my heart breaks when I think about a few of my peers from high school. A couple of names that come to mind are Gabe and Ariana and Josh, who have not been able to find the church to be a healthy place for them to be, for them to openly wrestle with a faith and wrestle with God. And they're not even finding the church to be relative to their life. But for some of you, it's not your peers. It's your children. It's your grandchildren or your great-grandchildren. And in the midst of my own wrestling, in the midst of my own battling the statistics, I'm always drawn to prayer. I'm drawn to prayer because that's where I need to find my hope. And I think that's where we find our hope as a body. So together this morning now, I think we need to go to prayer. I think we should go to prayer and ask God for wisdom. Wisdom in building relationships of reconnection that will allow all of us, not just me, but all of us, to participate in seeing God's faithfulness extended to a new generation. I want you to think of two young adults now. I want you to call to mind one young adult from your church, or a grandchild or a child who may have lost the faith. So think of that person now. Then also think about a young adult who is still in the church. Still in the church, still engaged with faith, still engaged with discipleship, and let's rejoice. And let's be thankful for that life. And let us pray with urgency. God is calling us to have an urgency for this generation. I think there is something powerful for all of us this morning, praying for all of those young adults that came to mind. I'm going to give you a time to pray silently, and then I will conclude our time of prayer with a prayer. Let us pray together. Oh God, we are drawn to you for hope. God, we come to you because you have first loved us. You have called each one of us by name and have given each of us an abundant and full life. You, oh God, love and care for your entire creation, for all of your people. And God, we are mindful today for my peers, for a generation who is lost and falling further away from you. For this, O God, we mourn. So God, we pray to you. God, grant us peace. Grant us grace. And grant us urgency to be in relationship with a new generation. So God, give us the minds to understand. Give us the words to affirm. And give us attitudes to love. Because you, O God, are the ultimate source of hope in this life. And God, we pray for every young adult that came to mind this morning. May each one of those young adults come to know you in a deeper and more holistic way. And God, we lift this all up in your holy and your amazing name. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Anna Knox, and I am a millennial. I'm also the pastor at Holly United Methodist Church in this conference. As a child in the class of 2000, I consider myself the ultimate millennial. And I say, as a millennial, don't put me in a box. Don't put me in any box, even one labeled millennial. I've seen what happens to people who are put in boxes. They're buried. Amen. I don't know about you, but I want to be alive and free. My Free to Be You and Me recording that I had as a child told me that on repeat, that I could be anything, anywhere, that I was unique, and my imagination and insight, I had the power with that to change the world. Millennials have been taught since childhood that they could accomplish anything that they set their minds to, not by necessarily submitting to authority, but by using every resource available to us creatively to engage the world. We have been taught by you to love the world, to explore it, to serve it. Be nice to others, we've been taught. Accept everyone, you told us. Have good self-esteem. Work in groups. Play on teams. Everyone gets a trophy. Everyone is a winner. And everyone in our generation from a very young age has had access to the internet. Oh, the blessed internet. That has made every opinion on this planet available to us at the tip of our fingers. So we have learned to consider all of the options and become open to a diverse global perspective. And somewhere along the way, we got the impression that the church was not a space that was open to creativity and questioning. This generation has gotten the distinct impression that the church is a closed box. So we must ask, have we shown people that the church is a place to go for authentic questioning? Kinnaman tells us that young Christians and former Christians too say the church is not a place that allows them to express doubts. They do not feel safe admitting that faith doesn't always make sense. And with such a broad worldview, millennials don't understand when the church says that their way, their traditions, are the only way. When the church tells us that we can't express doubts about a particular theology that seems incoherent or a tradition that doesn't carry meaning for us, we say, don't put us in that box. Let us figure out how we feel about things and walk with us while we do that. Let us ask questions that may lead to new insights for everyone. You know, I love my generation. We think deeply and we love widely. But my sadness is that in our quest to find communities that will engage our questions and our doubts, that are deeply interested in that, we don't even think to open the doors of a church. Because we've seen God too often embodied as judgmental and rigid. You know, in college, I got involved with a campus ministry, one that wasn't interested in my doubts and my questions, one that was only interested in telling me what to believe and telling me who I needed to become to be saved. And if that had been my religious wilderness experience, if that had been what led me to launch out into the world, I'm pretty sure I wouldn't have ended up here. And I'm pretty sure that I wouldn't be ordained tomorrow. But I was fortunate. My mother got ill, and my questioning heart came home to you. And I found in many of you in this community, these communities in central Pennsylvania, people who were eager and willing to listen to my questioning, doubting, angry, broken heart. And you showed me that you were willing to walk with me and let me explore and question. And I am so sad that I seem to be the exception. I encounter young people every single day who have not had the opportunity to have amazing, amazing mentors like I have had, to be encouraged, and also to be accountable to a community like that. And in conversations, I will often ask them to tell me about the God that they hope for but can't seem to find. And so often, the God that they describe is the one that I know in Jesus Christ. And I so wish that they would see that God, that loving, open God in us, a God that's full of questions and answers questions with more questions, who welcomes every single doubting Thomas into his embracing arms. I'm becoming a pastor for life in the United Methodist Church tomorrow. Not because somebody told me that I had to fit myself into a particular box of what a pastor or a Christian or a Methodist looked like, but because people showed me that Jesus was alive in me, and that through the unique combination of my questioning, hope-filled heart and the beloved community that you are, that we truly could come together to transform the world that I love for the good. And so if we really want to engage with young people, we have to dialogue with the question that Kinnaman asks: how can the Christian community help this generation face their doubts squarely and integrate their questions into a robust life of faith? And consistently I see that if we get out of our church box, if we don't allow ourselves to be buried, if we struggle and question together with millennials, everyone is a winner. And you know millennials love that. And maybe we'll find that we have more in common than we thought we did. And that together, we really do have the power to change this world.
Thank you. Thanks, Anna. So originally, I wasn't supposed to be on one of these chairs. I am not a millennial. I've aged out of the young adult category. Thank you. Yeah, I made it. But you know, as we kind of started to solicit young adults and millennials who could answer and respond to some of these disconnections that Kinnaman talks about in his book, We had a young adult who really wanted to be able to talk to two of those disconnections that are about the idea that oftentimes young adults perceive the church as repressive when it comes to sexuality and exclusive when it comes to others who maybe don't share their beliefs, or others even, as Kinnaman often talks about, who are of different sexual orientations is one of the things that Kinnaman talks about. And the truth is that we struggled through five or six revisions of what he might be able to say that might be able to be heard here in front of this huge group of people, and what might be helpful, and what might not put him in a position that might affect his relationships within the annual conference. And in the end, actually just this week, we came to the realization that we couldn't quite get to that place. And I think this is the fact that I'm here talking is actually a demonstration of this disconnection that Kinnaman talks about. These issues are so hot for us right now that we don't even know how to talk about them amongst ourselves. And that because of that, young adults who want to be able to have conversation and engage about this, and who might come from a different perspective than you do, struggle to find places where they can engage faithfully and honestly with sort of where they're coming from. And so part of what I want to share with you today, from not so much from a personal perspective, but just from a perspective of what I understand and have heard and know from young adults and millennials in this area, is that this isn't kind of, I don't want this to come off as about the issues of sexuality that we're dealing with in the church directly, because this is about who young adults are and what it means to engage them faithfully in conversation. But if you're going to engage, if we're going to faithfully engage in conversation and in faith and invite them to faith in Christ, one of the things that's really just important to understand about young adults is that for many of them, they just come at these issues from a different place than previous generations. And the generational shifts have happened so fast that many of us are left at a loss of even to know how to talk about it. I read, as we were preparing for this, a survey by the Pew Research Center that came out in February, and it was talking about generational differences about same-sex marriage, for example. And it was really interesting to see how wide of a gap there is. When you looked at folks who were over 68, the statistics were about, in the general population, about 35% of folks approved of same-sex marriage. But when you looked at the millennial generation, it was 70%. I mean, that's a huge gap. When they asked the question for young adult millennials who had disengaged from their faith and faith communities of why that was, 30% of young adults said that one of significant influences for them was the way that they've seen their friends be treated within the church and excluded from the church. This is a difficult reality that, again, just the fact that I'm the one sitting here and not a young adult speaks to how difficult this is to talk about. And all I guess I want you to hear today is that it's not something here to debate that issue or to say that you need to believe differently, but that in order to engage in ministry young adults in authentic relationship, this is a reality that you have to understand. And that what young adults are hungering for and longing for as they watch their peers, this relational generation that values community over rightness and looks for community and diversity and hurt for friends they see who are hurting, for a generation that is very comfortable talking about sexuality, but when they come into the church feel like there's a closed door about that conversation, is that part of what young adults are looking for is that they're watching the way that we treat others and that our witness is hurt when they feel that we are hurting those people who they love, and that they're looking for places of deep conversation. That isn't to say, again, that you have to change or rethink what you think, but we need to find ways to be in authentic conversation across our differences. And if we can't, there's a large part of this generation that for which the conversation will never even begin. The person who was doing the presentation, who wanted to do the presentation, ended his presentation with this, and I want to end with his paragraph. He said, "You know, as I ruminated on Kinnaman and his understandings, I wondered if part of the disconnection for us as young adults is because honest conversations about sexuality and about our experiences of that and our perception of that and the way that the church deals with that are never often even brought up. That we struggle to find a place where we can have true dialogue about these things. And it seems that the church has some barriers to starting conversations that young adults are already in. And it's our joint responsibility to learn how to have conversations that bridge this gap, that we can move faithfully ahead together."
Good morning. My name is Mindy Ferguson, and I am almost completed my first year of ministry serving at First United Methodist Church in Huntington. On a typical Saturday night, the majority of my friends are not thinking about going to church on Sunday morning. It's not that they don't believe in God or even that they aren't living out their faith in some way. But it has been their perception that the church has not been a place that has loved, supported, or encouraged them. Even the friends that I made when I was in youth group are no longer active members of the church. It's not that their experience was necessarily a bad one, but after they graduated high school, it was as if the church had, as a whole, forgotten them. And before, where our creativity, excitement, and unique ideas were valued when planning a youth service, those ideas have not been as easily accepted. What was once a sweet gesture by the youth is now viewed as a young person who just isn't satisfied with tradition. There is more of a sense of overprotectiveness of what is acceptable to come into the church from the outside than there was before. It's not really all that surprising that young people aren't in our churches. More specifically, it has been my and my peers' observation that sometimes the church seems to struggle with change. It is difficult to consider how allowing music, movies, influences, books, and poetry from the secular world to permeate the walls of the church. The issue with that is that young people are not leaving those things behind if and when they step foot inside our churches. There's not a fine line for young adults about what should or shouldn't be acceptable in the church. But this concern and resistance isn't only directed at young adults. We teach it to our children and our youth. We try to shelter them from all things secular. And while there is a lot of stuff out there in the secular world that we should want to guard our children and our youth from, there's also a lot to learn from. God is in a lot more than simply the things that we deem Christian or acceptable. This secular world we live in might be onto something. It has become a place where people can express who they are, explore who they want to be. And whether it's from hurt, disapproval, judgment, rejection, community can be found in places that don't cause these types of feelings. It is perceived by young people that the church hasn't been the place for that. So we've gone looking other places. I found friends with tattoos and piercings who have asked to cover up or remove them before entering the church. I've overheard conversations about young people wasting their money on damaging their bodies. And this quick judgment hurts deeply to my friends who have used this creative arts as a way to honor those who have passed away or to remember the time that they have served in the military. For many years now, I have participated in dance and worship. Sometimes when searching for a song, my dance teams have used songs that were not written by specifically Christian artists. In college, my dance team went to a church to worship through dance with them, and there was a lot of resistance to this type of worship. And it wasn't only because of the song choice, but also because of the dancing. We chose two different types of dance, both ballet and modern. And in my mind, there was no issue because this is how I best connect with God. But from the perspective of those watching, this was not the kind of thing that happened in church. It is not out of disrespect that young Christian adults are expressing themselves through things considered to be a part of the secular culture. And in many ways, these things help young people to discover who they are and who they were created to be. It helps us to connect to God in a way that things deemed Christian and acceptable cannot. Growing up, one of the best things that my church did was allowed a few local bands to play their music in the basement of our building. There were rules. The music wasn't allowed to swear, or it had to be respectful of the location. But what a crowd that event brought. There were young people of all ages in attendance. One of our youth leaders hung out in the kitchen as this event happened. And she was there to make sure that everything went okay.
But more than that, she showed us that she loved us and that she supported us. And it wasn't that she loved this particular type of music, but she knew how important it was to those who were there. Is the solution to the absence of young people in the church allowing any kind of secular music to fill our churches? Probably not. But in inviting this kind of event into their space, the church was communicating to their young people that they cared about them and that they mattered. That the church was interested in hearing about what was most important to them. It is not a guarantee that my friends who were once so involved in the youth group will return if there was a more openness to the secular world that we live in. But I think that being open to the possibility could open some doors. An openness to the possibility that our thoughts and interests and music and poems could be accepted in that space. And maybe it's an openness to allow pieces of who we are to enhance our worship together. Many young people are simply seeking to be in relationship with people they know authentically care about them. And that authenticity starts with a willingness to be in conversation with one another.
So I'm Luke Harbaugh. I am the associate pastor at First United Methodist Church in the sweetest place on earth, Hershey, Pennsylvania. And they made me go last because I have a happy ending to my story, and they thought it would be a good way to go out. They asked me to share last because my story is actually the opposite of a lot of millennials. I chose to engage with this idea of shallowness that Kinnaman talks about, and it allowed me to kind of reflect upon a period in my life where shallowness was the essence and was the heart of my faith. As I grew up, I was given a kind of a seed of an evangelical faith by my mom, who told me at the very young age, you know, you got to get right with Jesus, confess your sin, and make sure basically that you're not going to hell when you die. Now, in retrospect, that was a great place to start. That gave me a great foundation, but the problem was that that seed went unnurtured, unwatered for almost 18 years of my life. And so what I ended up with was a faith that was very shallow, one that was not engaged in any kind of community, one that never really grew. I couldn't even begin to define discipleship if I had tried when I graduated high school. And ultimately, what it led me to from Kinnaman's work was he talks about this idea of a moral therapeutic deism. And I don't know if any of you have heard that term before or not, but it's basically this idea that God, the way he's talked about in a lot of our churches and the way that I certainly grew up thinking about God is that he is part psychotherapist, you know, and part like motivational coach. That, you know, he's there to help you and maybe make you a little bit of a better person. And when you have trouble, well, that's when you pray to God and he's there to help you out and get you out of whatever bind that you're in. And unfortunately, when I graduated high school, that was really the faith that I possessed. But what was interesting was that through some of my friends in high school, I saw a different kind of faith take place and really grow in their lives. And when I graduated high school, I thought, well, I say I'm a Christian, but I don't really know what that means. And so I began to kind of seek out more answers. And the reason I say it's the opposite of a lot of millennials is that I went to church. I did not go to church growing up. I'd been to church maybe three or four times in the first 18 years of my life. And all of a sudden, I said, you know what, I think I'm going to start going. I want to know more about Jesus, and that's where they talk about Jesus, so that's where I'm going to go. And I started attending a Nazarene church and really found that my faith grew, and it was due to a couple reasons. Kinnaman talks about apprenticeships, about the idea that mentoring and really strong relationships with older people in the church are really important. And I established a very quick bond with the youth pastor and a very quick bond with the senior pastor. And it was through those relationships that I really became grounded in that particular community of faith. And so for me, I look at that shallowness that unfortunately we get a lot of times as Christians. And I think that the way we overcome that for millennials and overcome that as a church as a whole is to really focus on building relationships with people and building relationships with people that aren't in the church. I think about millennials in our church and engaging them with one another in Bible studies and small groups, engaging them with children, and those things happen a good bit. But one thing that is really lacking, I feel oftentimes, is millennials, young adults, engaging with older people in our congregations. That there's so much wisdom out there. There's so much life experience. There are so many people that have lived decades and decades of Christian faith, walking with the Lord, that and all that experience and all that knowledge never gets passed on to the young adults that are in our churches. And relationships were so important and so vital for me to connect to the church that I think one thing that I really am hopeful for and one thing that I really hope to see are those relationships take place and have the people in our congregations that are in their 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s go out into the community and start engaging young adults where they are and showing them what a life lived with Jesus Christ can truly give you in terms of wisdom, in terms of knowledge, and in terms of a faith to really live on as you go through and grow through life.
So you've had a lot to digest already, right? What I invite you to do, you have 1 minute and 15 seconds to do this, maybe 16, is to stand where you are, turn to a neighbor, and I just want you to share with them one thing that stuck out to you or was new to you in what you've heard. 1 minute and 15 seconds, go.
As we gather together here this morning, my name is Matt Lake. I am the pastor at First Church in Williamsport. And I also am here not because I am a young adult. I was asked to give my age, which is approaching 40, Tom. my son just said to me the other day, I got my hair cut, and he was trying to be nice. But he said, Dad, do you like gray hair? And I said, not particularly. He's like, oh, Dad, it's just fading right in. So, you know, so I'm not going to pretend I am a young adult, but I am here because one of the things that I have learned is we learn not only from those who have gone before us, but we learn from those who come after us. And one of the people who's most taught me that is no longer with us. Tom Cartwright did that for me. And I remember him specifically. Yeah. I remember him specifically seeking me out every year at annual conference to hear my voice and to learn from me. And I am really excited to learn from the people who are up here on stage. I know that time is there you go. They're excited
there
too.
There you go.
Preach, bro.
I know. Time is always against us. Isn't that a movie line, I think, somewhere? But we've checked with the bishop, and we're trying to take his command to us very seriously. Yesterday, he encouraged us, be real and have dialogue and conversation. And so we're doing that. And this is an important moment because it will pass all too quickly. So we will not be much longer, but we are going to take just a few moments to talk together here this morning because this is really, really important stuff. This is the future and the present of our church. And there are literally millions of lives and souls at stake. And so we're going to spend just a few more moments talking together a little bit about that. And, you know, let me just ask you, and just picture yourself, you're around a campfire right now with 1,000 of your closest friends, okay? That's kind of where we are. We just want to have a little bit of conversation with each other. If I heard you all correctly this morning when you were sharing, it was interesting to me when I think of young adult, I think I got to dress the right way. I got to get just the right hippest, coolest worship service. We got to get the best programs in place. If I heard you correctly, I didn't hear that from any of you here this morning. So you've already shared a lot of information for us this morning, but just in a few snippets, what would you say then young adults are looking for if it's not the cool programming and the hip worship? And what are they looking for?
Yeah, Matt, I think what you heard from all of us repeatedly was the word authenticity. You know, I have shared that with my church. You know, we've considered starting a contemporary worship service, and the reality is that we don't have the people to do that. We don't have the technology to do that. It's not us. And so what I've said to them is, young adults want us to be authentically ourselves. They want us to share who we really, truly are. And what you've heard a lot, I think, around this this topic is that they're looking for a space where they can be real too. And so if we can provide those spaces, but also go and find them where they are, because like I said, they're not coming to us, are they? And so to go and intentionally create spaces where those authentic conversations can happen.
So authenticity is certainly one thing. What else are young adults looking for that stick out to you?
I think young adults are looking for almost like reverse mentoring. I think we want to be mentored by people who are older and wiser than us, but I think I also want older people to ask us what we think, what we feel. And so it's that mutual relationship, it's that mutual growing. It's not just that one-way wisdom, but it's that deep relationship. And I think we just want to kind of do life together. We want to live among each other. We want to serve together. We want to grow together. We want to be in conversation together. So it's more than just that program, but it's more of just like this deep, intimate relationship, knowing that you authentically care, and that you really want to hear my voice. You don't want to hear my voice just because you want to have more young people.
Right. Mm-hmm. So authenticity, deeper relationship through forms such as reverse mentoring. What else sticks in your mind is what young adults are looking for?
I would say to go along with the relationships, a love with no strings attached. Often we, and this doesn't just go for young adults, but we're quick to judge based on, you know, whatever we see about a person, but really taking seriously the way that Jesus taught us to love people and loving in that way to build our relationships upon that.
Absolutely. So a love, when you say a love with no strings attached, would it be fair to say love in a very real way, without the preconceived notions of who you may or may not be, those boxes that you talked about, Anna. Great. Anything else that jumps to mind for you of what young adults are looking for, wanting to be a part of?
Yeah. And I think, and again, I'm not officially a young adult, so, but in working this and kind of having conversations with folks in preparing for this and others in my ministry, I think kind of authentic relationship kind of came up again and again and again. And I think there are kind of two pieces of that. Like one piece is authentic relationship means giving that space where like to connect in community, but like be part of the church, but not necessarily to do everything the way that you did it before. Like not to try and be hipper, but also to allow space for young adults to have a space where they can find their own way in the community and how to express that. And then I think secondly, like I was thinking, like authentic community kept coming up again and again. In a few minutes, we're going to look at a video what we did from young adults in our churches around the annual conference that we asked the question, why are you still part of the church, right? Like, why are you still here? And one of the things that came up again and again was sort of this idea of authentic community, right, and relationship. And so, like, I was kind of thinking about this last night, and I was thinking in some ways, like, part of what I hear is, like, these themes are barriers to community. And part of what the answer is sort of like, it's as easy and as hard as friendship, right? Like it's as easy and as hard as that. What does that authentically look like?
So let's touch on that a little bit, because I think all of us would sit here and say, right, we want to be authentic. We do not want to keep young adults out of the church. I think in some conversation, you know, the example was raised, Jesus says, love God, love your neighbor. We would all say we want to do that. It's right. The doing it that becomes the hard part. So as you all are sitting here today, can you try to give us some examples of what that might look like? Or maybe something that surprises us of what we would expect for young adults. For example, Chris, I heard you when you were sharing this morning, you were pretty clear in your presentation and with the statistics that it's not that we're trying to avoid deeper discipleship. In fact, if I hear you correctly, you might almost be calling us to deeper discipleship. And Luke, I've heard you talk about that as well. Could one of you or both of you comment a little bit on that?
I think one thing that we kind of underestimate people and we underestimate young adults. And I think one thing that we really want is a challenge. I think if you look at churches that require a lot of people, whether that's require a lot to become a member or require a lot of service, a lot of engagement in the community in order to be considered a part of the church, I mean, those often are churches that are growing. Those often are churches that are very healthy and vibrant. And I don't think that we require enough sometimes, especially from our young adults. We kind of throw the doors open really wide sometimes, and we say, you know, we're here for you, but once they're in, we don't challenge one another. We don't challenge each other in accountability or in holiness. And we end up with sort of a a really wide road in, but nothing there once they get there. And if we think about the people that we really respect in our lives, and the people that I respected growing up, they were teachers, and they were coaches, and they were my parents, and they were the people that really pushed me further than what I thought I could do. And in the church, a lot of times, I don't think we push people. I think we're afraid maybe to offend, or maybe we're afraid to alienate. And I think we have to really engage deeply on a personal level and push people's boundaries a little bit and say, you know, God desires more from you. God desires better from you. And really spur each other on towards holiness and towards godliness.
So as you say that, I mean, for me, there's sort of two things that strike me in that. My natural inclination would be, I want to make it as easy as possible for young adults. Right. That's sort of my thinking. Along with, I can't give them too much responsibility because I don't want to overwhelm them. But hearing you all, I almost hear like it's the opposite. Because one, they want a voice, I heard you say, which mm-hmm. comes with responsibility. But also, if I'm hearing you correctly, Anna, you know, you are change the world people. And yeah. So load those expectations on and let you go to it. Am I hearing that correctly?
Absolutely. I mean, we want to see a vital change in the community. I mean, one of my favorite things that's happened recently in our community is one of my atheist millennial friends that I hang out and play Frisbee with agreed to come and help us with the Church Has Left the Building initiative, right? So I don't know that he really realized what he was doing, but he came. And so he painted benches with the rest of us on a Sunday morning instead of being in traditional worship and was so passionate about it. And he recruited his friends. And so on our church video from this day, we have all these atheists hanging out with us, you know. He is passionately engaged in serving the wider world and wanting to do that with fervor and bring other people along. So. Yeah, absolutely. They want to see results, though. You know, they may not want to sit on a committee, but they want to see results, and they will work hard for it. So please ask us. Ask them to do things that matter.
Yeah. So as you're saying that, if I could just ask one or two of you very briefly to share, again, if this is not a program thing, where are you seeing examples in church, or maybe after this conversation, more specifically outside the church, where are you seeing authentic community happen? Where are you seeing relationships being built? Where are you seeing the mentoring or young adults being empowered to make a difference? Can one or two of you just give us a brief snippet of that? Because again, this is great language to throw out there, but our challenge will be to say, how do we create authentic community? What's one thing I can do to build deeper relationship? Could one of you throw out an example or two for us?
I mean, in the church that I'm working at, I think my whole role at the church, the whole reason I was hired to be there was to create that sense of community. And so I've been able to, not because of my position, but because of my age and my ability to relate to them, just form a community of young adults who they want to meet together. And this summer they have kind of asked to deal with the hard issues. They want to wrestle with them. They want to know what Jesus really thinks. They want to know what it's like to serve the community. And so for me, I almost felt like they were asking me to kind of form it, that they were wanting that to be done. And so I almost feel, I feel like that they want to do it. They're just waiting for it to be asked. Mm-hmm. They're just waiting to give them that space. To be free, not to terrorize the church, but to grow together as a community.
we do not want to terrorize the church. Chris, as you say that too, it's interesting. My tendency is to avoid confrontation at all costs. I mean, that's what I like, a smooth ship. If I'm hearing you all correctly, it's not such a big deal to you guys. Like, you'd rather be real, even if my opinion is different than yours, you're okay with that. Maybe I'm the one not okay with that. Yeah. Is that fair?
And I would say that's fair. And I think in the midst of that, I want you to be you so I can be me. So I want you to differ from me. I don't want you to think what I think. So because of that, I want that community so we can just honestly get down to the core and say, this is what I really believe. And I want you to accept me so then I can accept you for what you believe.
Great. Thank you. Yeah. Again, time is always against us, so we're going to wrap our time up here, and I actually would love to sit with you guys much longer, and I'm going to do that, actually. I hope that we can all do that together, but before we go, I'm just going to ask each one very quickly, anytime I come to a conference, part of me is craving, give me something to take away. So I'm going to ask these folks up here, if there was one thing, if you could wave that magic wand and say, I hope this is what we take away today, I hope this is what will happen, you can't go on very long. But what is the one thing you really hope today we could take away with us in this regard? And let's just move along. So Anna, start with you and move over.
Sure. I would like to see every young adult have the same kind of reception in a church that I had. I was a pastor's kid. I got the special treatment. I realized that. But I want to see that happen for every young adult so that when you ask a young adult a question on a Sunday morning, you stay to hear the answer and share with them a little bit of your life too. They will care and it will make a difference to them.
Thank you.
I guess I'd say kind of what I said before. I think it's about kind of a hunger for this authentic community that is able to even be in community sometimes across some wide differences, and friendship is easy and hard as that.
I would say intentionally seek out and love your young people.
Yes. I think to go along with that, outreach, evangelism, whatever you want to call it, is the responsibility of every single person in the church. It's not up to your pastors alone. It's not up to the volunteers and the leaders of ministry alone. It's the responsibility of every single person in the church to go out and reach out in the community, engage every age group, not just young adults, but especially us.
Tell us your story. Tell us the way that God has worked for you, so we can glean something and realize that, as you can see, we don't have the answers either. I know you want the answers, so let's work together. Let's be in this community together so all of us can reach young adults together.
Thank you. As I said, I wish we had a lot more time. I just know for me, listening to these folks, one of the things I feel like I have already learned is it is my task in helping to serve in a church. These folks are not targets to be conquered. They're people to love. And so, I want to thank you all for helping me learning that ever more. And really, the image that you all bring to mind is I just keep thinking of Jesus meeting the woman at the well, where she could ask all her questions and have real conversation and be loved as she was, and God did something amazing. So I thank you all for that. Having these kinds of conversations gives me hope. And it also gives me hope to have our bishop, because he has created this space to this dialogue. He followed up on what he said yesterday by creating this space. So can we thank him here this morning for that? Thank you. We really do believe that this is where answers begin. How did God bring the world into existence? Through his spoken word. And we received that opportunity this morning. I receive hope listening to these folks. I receive hope from Bishop Park. We want to leave you with a word of hope, remembering that the God we serve is bigger than any obstacles or challenges we face. And so as a final word of hope here this morning, I invite you to turn your attention to the screen and to know that God is moving among us and he's not done with us yet. Let's share together.
Why am I still connected to the church? Why am I still connected to the church?
I stayed connected with our church because I feel like they have been like a family to me. My dad was diagnosed with cancer at the beginning of the year, and our church has stepped up not only to pray for us, but to provide support, food, and at times just a shoulder to cry on. I've also experienced a family-like atmosphere in our young adult community and fellowship.
We've made some really great friends there, and we've had some great opportunities to serve through Upward Ministries, through Vacation Bible School, and through some other service projects. So it's really grown to be a place where we feel connected and in a way that we don't feel that in any other aspect of our lives.
It comes down to community and stability. I like having a wider community of people that I know I can get support from if I need, and that care about me as an extended family.
The people that I worship with and were at my church really connected me, and there's the folks that I hung out with on weekends and doing stuff and all sorts of different things beyond just Sunday mornings, and they really kept me connected to that. And also the ministries helped me to be able to exercise gifts that I couldn't really exercise anywhere else.
I go to church because I love the fellowship and the community and the love and support and the hope that I get from it.
Hi, I'm Manira, and I go to church for God reassurance as well.
I love the fellowship.
Yep, you.
Hi, my name is Ethan, and I go to church to build my relationship with God and to discover God's plans for my life.
And I have a little more personal reason going back to church. Not so long ago, I'm not not exactly comfortable saying this, but I had thoughts of suicide, and that's why I go back to church, and I was pushed back to go to church, and I'm so glad I did, because it's like my whole life.
Just signed up for softball.
Amen.
Because I think that people fundamentally deserve to be loved and cared for, and I think if you want to express that to people, and I want to express that fundamental belief that I have, that being a part of the church is one of the best places to do so.
Because I'm a disciple of Jesus, I have two goals for each day: to love the Lord my God with all my heart, my soul, my mind, and my strength, and to love my neighbor as myself. And I've come to the conclusion that being part of the church is the best place for me to do that.
I think the church is pointing towards something better.
So I think I'm still in the church today just because I've been on the other side. I lived a very individualistic, self-help kind of faith as a teenager, and it ultimately was not a genuine relationship with God. And it wasn't until I walked into the church that I really saw God at work in some really great and fabulous ways, not only in my life, but in the lives of other people.
It's because of people that I've encountered there and the relationships that I've had. That the Christian life really does work, and that it really is something that points to God's kingdom, and it's kind of a fulfillment of life as it's supposed to be, even though it's imperfect. That the people who have lived that kind of faithful life really give an example that I think that show me to the point that I can say, yeah, I think this would actually work. I think I can stick with this, and I want to.
Cool. Church is where I first met Christ, and the church is the place where I experience time and time again the gift of community. A community that nurtures me, that supports me, a community that challenges me, and a community at its best that always makes me feel welcome.
Because of books. Read about the hope that the church can offer against racism, sexism, and all these really issues that we have in our world, like poverty and so many other issues. And I think the only reason I'm still here is because I remember that Christ calls me to change those issues with the body.
Serving in New Orleans and Guatemala and in Haiti has changed who I am and allows me to see that we're a church much more concerned about our community and our world than we are about our worship buildings and our space on Sunday mornings.
I've had so many great mentors in faith, from Sunday schools to youth group leaders to college ministers, who believe that it was important enough to invest their faith in my own journey. And for that, I'm grateful.
As people on campus ministry invested into me and helped me see the future and hope of the church.
I believe that Jesus Christ is the greatest hope of the world, and that the church is the hands and feet of Jesus Christ in the world.
I've seen churches that are reaching out to their communities in new and creative ways to reach young people who are outside the church with the message and hope of Jesus Christ. I'm still here because we are truly changing the world around us, one person at a time.
I honestly believe that the church is the hope for this world, that this is what Jesus Christ intended for each and every one of us.
I'm still here.
I'd like to ask the whole body, would you stand, and would you express your appreciation for the leadership that we have seen this morning? Because their presence and ministry and leadership among us, I would like to claim that the young adult generation is not a lost generation, but the generation yet to be claimed by the church. And we will do it together. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let the church say amen. Praise the Lord.